in a way the horse is bolted. If you were going to redesign the system from scratch, you would have a single funding system, and you could still have within that, you know, various tendencies, whether they were philosophical or religious, but you'd have a system that was based on all citizens' needs rather than segmented and differently funded as it currently is. So the systems that do that typically have lower inequality, which is, as I say, I think an important objective to reduce that. So that's one thing. The other thing is I do worry about the instrumental interpretation of education's value, that it's, and this is not putting down the need for appropriate vet training, but testing and a lot of the way we think about education is constantly looking to what the employer might need or what the person might need in their later life. But as you were saying earlier, the world that these young people will inhabit is not likely to be one that we recognise today. So educating them for creativity, flexibility, having the basics, but in a way the basics are the easiest thing to teach. Engaging people in wanting to learn for the rest of their lives is important. And systems like Finland's, I think, are very interesting. They don't test their kids at all. No NAPLAN, nothing. They don't test them till they're 16, I think, as they're going into their last 2 years of schooling. They don't start formal schooling till the children are seven. The teachers are required to have a master's degree. They're amongst the best paid occupations in the country. And it's very difficult to get into teaching. The schools are neighbourhood schools for the most part. Admittedly, it's a more concentrated community and wouldn't suit us, that part of the model. But where possible, neighbourhood schools, you stay there from the time you go into school. The preschool is not school at all. It's essentially, if you like, stimulation and creativity, and the children don't get anywhere near a desk, I think, until they're seven, and they're not called school children until then. And the result is that Finland's right at the top of the league table. In fact, at one stage, the Finnish education minister said he was sick of dealing with all these people who were trying to increase their PISA scores, because when they got there, they said, oh, we couldn't possibly do that in our country. It's all too free form. And the children in the classroom, for example, not only do they have highly qualified teachers, the teachers spend less time in the classroom than our teachers do. They spend more time on curriculum development, and they actually have more genuine autonomy. Autonomy at a school level is one thing, but the respect for and capacity of the teachers to use the sorts of knowledge and experience that they presumably get in the university education to craft what's going on in the classroom to suit the children they have. They say, if there's a child that comes through my hands that is failing, I take that as a personal responsibility. And they have extra resources for the bottom 30% of the children who are not doing well. I think that has a lot to offer us. By the way, they take the kids out of the classroom, even in the middle of winter, every 20 minutes or so for a 10-minute break. They spend a lot of time outside, and the little kids spend only little bits of time in the classroom. And we know from psychology that that kind of learning is much more effective than big chunks of time inside a closed room, even if the desks are a bit novel in the way they're configured. We still teach as if we're Prussians from the 19th century.
Prussians.
We do.
And I'm happy to throw this open as to what any of you think are possible ways that we might be teaching education. If you were education minister in 25 years, what do you think you might be looking at, Mark? Liz?
How do you know? Where's the crystal ball for us? Mm. Since I left Parliament, I've been here at UWA, and the thing that I've noticed each year as a new group of undergraduates comes in is, I think, a growing gap between their experiences in schools and their experiences in the university, where once upon a time in this university and all universities, there'd be a professor at the front of a large auditorium like this or classroom like this speaking to the student. That has changed dramatically. At this university, there's a Pro Vice Chancellor for Education Innovation, and looking at all sorts of things and working with staff to change the way they actually deliver their courses. So the flipped classroom, all those things are, with the aid of technology, really changing the face of what happens in universities across the world. I take Peter's point that quite a lot's changed in schools and technology and so on. But in year 11 and 12, it's just as it was really when I was at school. There's those exams at the end of year 12 that you as an individual work towards to get your mark to get into university. That's not really how universities are working now. You've got, in pathology and health sciences, there's a fantastic lab over the other side of the Stirling Highway that seats 170-odd students who work in groups of six on computers solving problems together. So problem solving, working in groups, and all those sorts of things are changing and have changed what happens in universities. I don't necessarily, perhaps I've been out of touch too long, but I don't think that's happening in schools. And I think making sure the transition from school to university is something that we've worked on hard here, and I know lots of other universities are doing the same thing, to make sure that the transition is smooth and the first year experience for students really works well for them. So I think that perhaps schools and universities need to start a dialogue and discuss these things in some way. I'd like to see that happen to see if they can help those many of those students make the transition, a smooth transition from school to university.
Yeah. Can I just add just something to that? And I just want to step away a little bit from curriculum for a moment, even though that is first and foremost in terms of the role and in terms of the development of a child in preparation for life skills, not just for employment, but for life skills across the board. But I think what you're seeing a lot more of it in the last decade in particular, and this will continue to be elevated in terms of the role of schools and education in a very generic sense, inevitably in the decades ahead, is the fact that in an increasingly complex society, our schools are being called upon to play a much broader role than just curriculum development. You know, you've got so many complex issues that kids bring with them from kindergarten through to year 12 on a day-to-day basis. Now, we're not just talking about the usual suspects in the hard-to-staff areas or the remote areas of the state. We're talking in a very general sense in our schools every day that teachers have to deal with. Mm. So you cannot talk, and you will not be able to talk about education in a broad sense by just talking about curriculum any longer. Pastoral care and student services are going to be 50-50. And education is going to be increasingly called upon to provide those wraparound services in terms of support, in terms of mental health support, in terms of cultural awareness for a whole raft of reasons, in terms of the multicultural society. And all of these issues now are faced by our schools. We're not Nigel No Friends in this space. This isn't just in Western Australia. This is a global phenomenon. Schools now are being called on to perform a much broader role than they ever have, and that will just continue to increase.
And yet I'm sure every teacher in the audience here would say they have minutes to get their subject across every day, every week, and haven't got the time to go into providing for changes in mental health issues, childhood obesity,
I'm not talking about
the
teachers,
migrant mix, the things that are happening in our community, which schools invariably reflect.
I agree with that. I'm not talking about that, a lot of those responsibilities are on the shoulders of teachers, but I'm talking about, as I said, those support networks. Student services now is a discrete area of most of our senior high schools. They have a discrete student services area, which provides a chaplain and a school psychologist and year leaders, etc. You'll find that area will inevitably broaden to cope with that increasing pressure on the shoulders of the school in a very general sense.
Mm. Well, but I want to come back to this.
Look, I'm the furthest removed from current education decision-making, so my prognostications are probably the least accurate of all of them here. But I'll make two general observations. Firstly, I think in the next 25 years, we'll see a gradual increase in the degree of independence of schools and then a swing back towards a more centralised system as the weakness... As the weaknesses of... unduly independent systems come. I mean, I've always been a subscriber to a cyclical view of history. What goes around comes around. You don't have to read too much history to see that mostly works. But I'm optimistic about it there, because I think each time the pendulum swings back, it's an improvement. You know, we finish up, might swing this way and then back, but we always finish up a little bit further ahead than we were the time before. So I do see continuing improvement in this. But I make one point about resources. I heard Carmen and the others. In 1987, the Bulletin ran an article, a major article, about the difficulties Rod Cavalier, my New South Wales counterpart, and I found in trying to make major education reform in a time of constrained resources. Now, I think everyone on the panel has faced that same issue. And I'm looking at the political situation in Australia at the present time, I see no possibility of substantially increased resources for education in this country inside the next 25 years. In fact, what is going to happen is, as is happening in most other areas, we're going to get more constrained resources. So the reality of it is, as I had to try and do all of those reforms back in the 80s without any increased resources, I think that is actually going to be the message for the education community. A lot needs to be done, but you're going to have to do it by reallocating, by reworking the resources that you have. Now, I know it's a message probably no one wants to hear, but I must say I personally think that is the reality of politics in Australia today.
Mm. Mark, would you agree?
Oh, resources are always an issue. Always an issue. Budgets are inevitably tight. But 25 years from now, I don't know if we can predict. I can say what I hope is the case. If you have a look back 25 years, back when Bob was the minister, I think there was one computer per every 30 students or thereabouts. And those great big things that sat on the desk that had the green light.
There were no computers.
No computers. Not enough resources, Bob. Not enough resources. But if you go back...
We had paper, I remember that.
If you go back 25 years, you couldn't have predicted what it would look like today with technology and the like. You go forward 25 years, I imagine technology will be something today we can't imagine. I imagine that we will have embraced it even more. I do hope for a few things, though. First of all, I hope that when students are studying social sciences or history or the like, they're looking back at some oddities called Twitter and Facebook that were around at this point in time as part of their history studies, no longer being in existence. And I do also hope that I might be a bit of a traditionalist, I just hope we never lose the sort of the, you know, literacy, numeracy and writing and vocabulary and the capacity to construct a sentence and write a story and do all those things, because these days I so often come across kids, young people, who the language and the written word has lost what it once was. And now, I'm not a Shakespearean scholar, I'm not any of those things, but I do love the written word, I do love the capacity to express, I do love the capacity to read and write. And I do hope that our education system, with the advance of technology, never loses those basics that we still take for granted as being core values within our education system.
Premier, I want to give you the final word as we have just gone over time. As you travel around the state, are you heartened by what you're seeing? Are you despairing? Are you thinking that really quite substantial change needs to occur, or do we have a model that is delivering well enough?
Look, I think we've got a good school system, and I think we need to remember that. The vast majority of schools and school communities and students I see, I think, are doing well. There are examples. One comes to mind, going to a school and a teacher telling me that several of the children in her class don't want summer holidays. They don't feel safe, they want to stay at school. And I find that sort of comment incredibly sad. I agree with what Peter was saying, that schools are going to have to play a bigger role in the personal and social development of young people, young children. But at the same time, I think we've got to take care that we don't place all of the issues and problems of society on our schools to solve. And I think every minister, with the tragic road accidents over the weekend, it's a wonder we haven't had commentary about, you know, road safety in schools and all these programs. We need to keep schools to education. And the final comment I'd like to make is I think, you know, we can underestimate the importance of leadership. And from some of the research that I read quite a few years ago, that, you know, the thing that would make the biggest difference in a school is the leadership, the principal, the senior, you know, position in the school to inspire, to lead. And related to that is, I think you can, if you believe in something and it's the right thing to do, there is always a way of solving the problem. And I disagree with Bob a little bit. I don't sort of get too upset about resources issues. I think if it's right and there's a problem to solve, you can do it. And I'll give you one example from my time. Wasn't the biggest issue, but we changed the school starting age. A simple issue that everyone could understand and thinking about their son or their daughter. And the only way we solved the problem was to make sure the change in school starting age didn't apply to any child who had been born at that stage. And that solved it.
Thank you.